invite you to open your Bibles with me to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, verses 1 through 12. It'll also be up on the screen. But I mentioned last week that we are hitting a series here of difficult, challenging topics that Jesus spoke on in his ministry here in the Gospel of Mark. And yet, these are the teachings of Jesus. And Jesus was a person. Jesus is God, and that means he is full of grace and truth. And so I, as a pastor, I, as a preacher, I, as a brother Christian, want to follow that same road, to walk in the path of righteousness, to walk in the path of grace, but also recognizing that God has a holy and perfect will that does not always match up with how we live. And so when we go against that will, we are sinning, we are grieving God, we're doing something that has caused, in part, Jesus to have to go to the cross, to give himself up for us, to redeem us, because our sin grieves God. And yet, any time that we hear God, I also want us to be careful that we don't miss the important part of the message, or just as important part of the message. That for those who believe and repent, those who confess with their mouths Jesus is Lord, and those who say, God, would you forgive me? I have wronged you. I have offended my neighbor. That with that repentance, God always has grace for us. And so as you might guess from the title of the message, and if you have the passage open before you, today we're approaching this topic of marriage, divorce, and adultery. Let's hear the word of the Lord. Jesus then left that place and went into the region of Judea and across the Jordan. Again, crowds of people came to him, and as was his custom, he taught them. Some Pharisees came and tested him by asking, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" "What did Moses command you?" he replied. They said, "Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. It was because your hearts were hard that Moses wrote you this law," Jesus replied. "But at the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but they are one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let man not separate." Now notice here that the disciples themselves struggled with this. When they were in the house again, the disciples asked Jesus about this. And he answered, "Anyone who divorces his wife and marries another woman commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another man, she commits adultery." So far, reading of God's word this morning. May he give his blessing to it and to our message. Brothers and sisters in Christ, you've probably heard from some pastor or from someone before the startling statistics about divorce rates in our country, that as high as 40 to 50% of marriages do not last forever. And so statistically speaking, that's one in every two marriages is not going to last. It will end in divorce. And sadly, that percentage is true throughout our world, but perhaps even more shocking to us, it's true in the church. And I think about our church, and a number of us have experienced divorce, or we know a family member or a friend who has been divorced. And some recent studies, I think in a good way, show a downward trend in divorce recently. They show that as young people wait longer and longer to marry, or perhaps don't get married at all, that divorce rate isn't as high. And yet we need to be clear that divorce isn't something new. It's not something that just came about in the 20th century, but it has been around for thousands of years. Here we are almost 2,000 years ago, and the Pharisees are asking, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? It's not the first time they've asked about the lawfulness of something, and it won't be the last in Mark. What they're asking is it right? Is it permissible? Is it okay? Does a person have a legal right to divorce? And the Pharisees knew what they thought, but they wanted to test Jesus. What does he think? How does he match up with our opinions, our supposed biblical truths? And in likely the same account in Matthew 19, the question is this. It's a little bit longer. Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason? And I think about that today in our context. I think about those of you who I've had the pleasure of doing premarital counseling with, and for those that haven't but are married, and for those who premarital counseling wasn't even a thing, I doubt a half, let alone a quarter of us, would say that during our dating years and during our engagement and on our wedding day, that there was ever a serious question in our minds, are we going to be divorced or separated in the future? Just yesterday morning, a buddy of mine from Indiana who now lives in Northwest Iowa texted me and he says that he successfully proposed. That's how I'm going to say it. He successfully proposed to his girlfriend. And I'm excited for him. It's been a long time coming. And yet I think back in their relationship, and there was a time several years ago where they did break up. But now they got back together, and they've been together since then. And I thought about it. What if I asked him, do you think you might get divorced one day? He'd say no, and likely he'd probably be a little bit offended at me. And he'd be offended because the mentality that I think most of us have when we enter into that marriage conversation is that we hope in the weeks and the months and the years that we have dated that hopefully we've worked everything out, that we've learned enough about our future spouse, that we know what it is that gets on our nerves, that we can deal with whatever that is, and hopefully even that we've had most of the big arguments. And as I think all of us who are married know, we get married and life happens. Work, kids or not having kids, death, money, moving, difficulties all enter into our lives. And just a year ago, if we go ahead to the next slide, the Today Show had this article, 6 Major Reasons Why People Divorce. Here they are, infidelity, that one person or both spouses have cheated on the other. They've been unfaithful. Money problems. And this was interesting. They write, money in and of itself doesn't cause divorce, but stress or differences of financial views can lead to fighting, which can result in divorce. Addictions, extraordinary circumstances. You think of a couple who goes through an injury or goes through a certain event that is going to change everything. Or a child dies, similar to what Christy and I went through. We were told when we found out about Ellie a year ago, just this week, that many couples who experience that end up being divorced. But then we have the last two, incompatibility. We're just too different. And 6, irreconcilable differences. We just can't work it out. There is no hope. As I think about those are real life situations. Those are real life events, real life struggles. And I think some of them, maybe we look at it and we say, well, you know, when we're dating or when we're engaged, maybe we can see that happening. Maybe we can kind of plan for that. But most of them are simply not expected. And because of that, a couple can neglect any type of meaningful preparation for them. And then when trouble strikes in the marriage, many try to fix it on their own. They try to go at it for a while, but then they get to this point where they say, you know what, we can't do it on our own, and they need to go looking for help. And yet couple after couple comes in and they say, it's too late, I think. That one of us or both of us have checked out on the marriage. And so here's the truth for those of us who are married, for those of us who are dating, or for those of us who hope to one day marry. The kind of commitment that a good, strong marriage requires is not something that dating can really prepare us for. The kind of commitment that a strong and good marriage requires is not one that dating really prepares us for. It is not one without any problems necessarily. And so a committed marriage, a good marriage, a strong marriage is one that requires us to have dedication to one another in every type of moment. And yet divorce is real in our world. Divorce is real in our culture. Divorce is real in our churches. And yet God's holy and perfect will is laid out for us in Mark 10, if we go ahead to the next slide. Verses 6 through 9, but at the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. Those words are as old as Genesis 1 and 2. But Jesus continues on. So they are no longer two, but they are one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let man not separate. As we've gone through this series in the book of Mark, I tried to paint sort of that biographical, that look at what was life really like for Jesus and for his disciples and for these crowds. And one of the pieces of that is that we don't see Jesus as being married. There's some ideas and some things out there that say, well, I think he was married to Mary Magdalene. Maybe he was, but from what we know in the Bible, in Mark, we don't find that. And yet I don't think Jesus was naive. Jesus knew that marriage wasn't easy. I know that. Most of us know that marriage is difficult, and it's often difficult because we change and our spouses change and life happens and it isn't always pretty. But I want us to come back to this question. What union have we entered into? Is it just our vows, our decision, our marriage? In the Screwtape Letters, author C.S. Lewis writes about a fictional but rather believable correspondence happening between an elder or senior demon named Screwtape and his nephew, a demon in training named Wormwood. And it's all about attempts to lead a certain man to our father below, or the devil. And in the book, the enemy is God, or the enemy is Jesus. And so in one of these letters, Screwtape is addressing how you use sexual temptation to lead someone to their direction, to our father below. And he writes this, we could put this up. In the humans, the enemy, again, this is God, has gratuitously associated affection between the parties, between a man and a woman, with sexual desire. He has also made the offspring dependent on the parents and given the parents an impulse to support it, thus producing the family, which is like the organism, only worse. For the members are more distinct, yet also united in a more conscious and responsible way. The whole thing, in fact, turns out to be simply one more device for dragging in love. And as you think about that, the Christian faith is built around love, and the devil's domain in the Screwtape Letters is against love. And so this is something that's trying to pull people away. But Screwtape continues, now comes the joke. The enemy described a married couple as one flesh. He did not say a happily married couple or a couple who married because they were in love. But you can make the humans ignore that. And considering what God declares throughout his word, considering what we've heard in Jesus himself today, that's true, isn't it? That if we are to marry, if we are to enter into this supposed marital bliss, this holy matrimony, this thing that we call Christian marriage, then we're saying, you know what? I want to follow God's will for marriage. I want to honor him. I want to honor my spouse in this. But what that means, what that's based on, is not some worldly sense of happiness. It's not some worldly sense of romantic infatuation. It's not sexual desire. It's not any other beautiful or good emotion or feeling. Not to say that any of those things are bad, but the purpose and the root of Christian marriage is the two that God has made one. And if we're not careful, if we're not intentional in our marriages, that is so easy to forget about. That is so easy to ignore. And when we do that, that is when divorce becomes that much more plausible, that much more a reality, that much more an acceptable thing and not that big of a deal. I want to spend some time just this morning just walking through the scriptures on divorce. And there's not a lot of them, actually. This is what we're going to walk through is most of them. Let's go ahead to the next slide. There are seven terms or seven words that we find across scripture that speak to divorce or separation. So in the Hebrew, in the Old Testament, there are two. The words keratut and the word salah. And then in the Greek, there's five words. Apoluo, epistasion, aphiemi, horizo, not chorizo like the sausage, and ex apostello. That is only in the Septuagint. And I give you those words because if you were to study them, if you were to look up on a Bible software program, where do they show up? You would find that a word like salah actually shows up 847 times. And yet the Bible doesn't talk about divorce 847 times, but it does talk about sending away, sort of in a generic term. And so I put these before you with their definitions because I want us to see that how the Bible describes divorce is of a spouse sending out or dismissing or releasing the other. The other way it talks about divorce is that you are leaving or abandoning your spouse, your partner. And so as we go through the next number of slides, you're going to see passage after passage. And I've underlined the word that's being talked about as divorce or as separation, and then what word follows. So we're just going to work through these texts one after another. Deuteronomy 21, verse 14. If you are not pleased with a beautiful woman among captives who you've taken as your wife, let her go wherever she wishes. You must not sell her or treat her as a slave, since you have dishonored her. Deuteronomy 22 through 13 through 19 describes this. If a man takes a wife and after lying with her, dislikes her and slanders her and gives her a bad name, saying, I married this woman, but when I approached her, I did not find proof of her virginity. If it's found out that he has lied, he shall be punished and pay a fine to the father for giving an Israelite virgin a bad name. She shall continue to be his wife. He must not divorce her as long as he lives. A few verses later, if a man happens to meet a virgin who is not pledged to be married and rapes her, and they are discovered, he shall pay a fine to her father. He must marry the girl, for he has violated her. He can never divorce her as long as he lives. Just a short comment on that. I didn't study it real in depth, but I'm wondering there if when it uses that word rape, we're not to think about rape as it would be today, but it's simply that completely out of the confines of any relationship that they had sex together. I wonder if that's a better translation of that. We'll go on to the next one. Deuteronomy 24, 1 through 4. This is where, when we look at Mark 10 and it talks about a certificate of divorce, what we're talking about. If a man marries a woman who becomes displeasing to him because he finds something indecent about her, and he writes her a certificate of divorce, gives it to her, and sends her from his house, and after she leaves his house, she becomes the wife of another man, and her second husband dislikes her, he writes her a certificate of divorce, gives it to her, and sends her from his house, or if he dies, then the first husband who divorced her is not allowed to marry her again after she has been defiled. That would be detestable in the eyes of the Lord. Do not bring sin upon the land the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance. Along the same lines, we've looked at Malachi chapter 2 before, if we can put that up. And I just want to highlight here the last words of verse 16, that the Lord God says, I hate divorce. So this is how the Old Testament talks about divorce, about the separation between husband and wife. Let's move into the New Testament now. And we find several passages outside of our own. Matthew 1 tells us that Joseph, the earthly father-to-be of Jesus, he had in mind to divorce Mary when he found out that she was pregnant with Jesus. Matthew 5 is part of the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus says, it has been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a certificate of divorce. But I tell you, anyone who divorces his wife except for marital unfaithfulness causes her to become an adulteress. And anyone who marries the divorced woman commits adultery. And we get into our passage. Let's go ahead to the next slide, too. I'm not going to read all of these, but you can notice there are some common words. Apoluo, apostasion, and charizo. Again, divorce is talking about a separation, a sending out, and that legal official certificate of divorce. There's one other key place in Scripture that talks about divorce. Let's go ahead to the next slide. This is 1 Corinthians 7. And there's two parts here. The first part is addressed to those who are married. Verses 10 and 11, Paul writes, to the married I give this command, not I, but the Lord. A wife must not separate from her husband, but if she does, she must remain unmarried or else be reconciled to her husband, and a husband must not divorce his wife. And ephemia there, when it comes up again, that's one of those leaving or abandoning terms. They are not to do that. You get to verse 12 through 15, and this is the second part. To the rest, I say this, I, not the Lord. If any brother has a wife who is not a believer and she is willing to live with him, he must not divorce her. And if a woman has a husband who's not a believer and he's willing to live with her, she must not divorce him. For the unbelieving husband or wife has been sanctified through his wife or through her believing husband, but if the unbeliever leaves, let him do so. A believing man or woman is not bound in such circumstances. God has called us to live in peace. Let's go ahead to the next slide. That is the flyover look at the main scriptures that deal with divorce. And again, like I said before, this is about every single one in Scripture that talks about divorce. There's not a lot more out there. The reason why I bring them up is because if we're asking, why is divorce really that big of a deal? Is it sinful? Is it not sinful? There are some things that I think we hear in these verses. For one, divorce or separation between husband or wife, it involves a dishonoring of the spouse. We also hear about how sex is this incredibly intimate thing, that sex is a beautiful thing in the confines of marriage. And yet when it leaves that relationship, when other people are involved, there is a violation or a violating, or a defiling rather, of the person. And then thirdly, in various ways, divorce also can involve a breaking of faith. That you've broken trust, you've broken devotion to your partner. And the reason why this is, it's not just about our relationship, but we go back to Mark 10. We go ahead to the next slide. And again, that final part, this is God's will. They are no longer two but one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let man not separate. And so I invite us to think about marriage in a certain way. I'm inviting us to think about marriage in this life-giving light. That you have a lifelong commitment to one person, and that is a beautiful thing that God, our Creator, has given you. And yet the way that makes divorce easily permissible to a lot of people is to say, look, it's my marriage. It's my ideas. You know, I shouldn't just have to pick one fish in the sea and hope it's the best one, and if it's not, then I'll go search out another fish. No, we need to see it in the way of covenant. And so of all the ways to look at Christian marriage, the old term wedlock, if we go ahead to the next slide, is the one that I've been gravitating to recently. And let's be clear that I'm twisting the word wedlock. Wedlock just means the state of being married. And so Christy and I are in wedlock. And yet I think about it because it makes me think the two words that make it up, wed and lock, of a padlock. That you consider this two becoming one, that these two do not separate, that they do not send away, that they do not dishonor, they do not leave. And this is God. God who has brought these two people together, God who locks us together in our marital relationships, and he has the key. And so marriage isn't primarily about my vows. Marriage isn't primarily about our happiness. Marriage isn't primarily about our pleasure. Because if it's any of those things, then I think we can look at it and we can simply say, well, has he let me down too many times? Or has she failed me over and over and over again? And I'm going to make my decision of whether we should stay together or split up based on that. But I think marriage for us as Christians need to be looked at in this light. Is it under God? Is it under what we've been talking about in these biblical passages? I want to be absolutely clear because I'm sure it's on some of our minds. What about certain cases? What about the accounts of abuse? What about the accounts of spousal neglect or of harm? Is Jesus naive to that? Does he just not care? And I think if we look at the real world, there are times when power is used in an overbearing way in that relationship between a husband and wife where no reconcile is desired. And if that is the case, if safety or well-being is in question, then leaving, divorce, separation may be the appropriate response for a believer. Yes, you've been brought together as one. No, your happiness every single moment of your life is not the most important thing in marriage. But God does call spouses to live in love, to live in respect, to live in honor, and to live submitting to one another. And when one spouse is terribly offended that, when one spouse mocks change, a marriage, I think, can be viewed biblically as loss. And separating for the good of at least one of the spouses may be appropriate. And yet we look back at what Jesus is talking about here, what I'm calling God's holy and perfect will, and what it's talking about is when we just do this kind of willy-nilly, when we just say, you know what, I'm bored. Or you know what, I just don't feel the same way about my wife as I did when we were younger. Or you know what, we're just different people. Those are not weighty enough reasons for a couple to separate or abandon what God has brought together. And so brothers and sisters, may our marriages reflect the marriage of Christ and his church. Hear these hopeful and these instructive words from Ephesians 5, if we go ahead and put the last slide up. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. And so husbands, love and cherish your wives. Wives, love and cherish your husbands. And church, love your husband, the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave everything for us and who loves us, wretched though we are. He loved us first, and he loves us still. Amen. Would you pray with me? Well, Lord our God, these are not easy things, and it's easy to assume in one another that we are wrong, that we can't possibly know what one another is going through, that this can't possibly apply to us. And yet, Lord, we invite you into our hearts and into our lives, and yes, into our marriages, to test our affection, to test our feelings, to test our emotions, to test that sense that we say, you know what, I think it is just for me to separate. It is just and it is legal, it is lawful to get a divorce. Oh Lord God, again, we recognize that there are appropriate times, that there are times where you honor that, when there has been unfaithfulness in our marriage and in whatever form that may be. And yet, oh God, would you bring us back to reflect on that call that you have given us, that you are the one who makes two one, that you are the one who brings us together, and that we are not to separate the sacred bond that you have put in place in our homes. Oh Lord God, in all that we do, may we seek to honor you, to glorify you. And Lord, for those of you whom this has been a struggle, who this is something very real for us, Lord God, would we know your grace? Would we know your forgiveness? Would we know that there is hope? Lord, that we have not overstepped too far, that we are in danger, that we are continuing to offend you, but that your grace is enough in our homes, whether they are broken or whole. All this we pray in your Son's precious name. Amen.